So once again, I welcome you all to this very special 116th session of Leadership Talks. As you know, that these sessions are being organized by India International Education Council and School Lalaji Solutions. India International Education Council is a not-for-profit organization which is working in the field of education. It has collaborators from 12 countries. India International Education Council aims to create a better world through education. It also building quality centers for elementary education approachable for all kids, finding best educational practices across the globe and find ways to implement those in Indian institutions. It is also trying to create more awareness on hygiene and learning disabilities. It publishes a magazine called World Education Review and many other educational reports. It aims to build 100 chapters in different cities by 2022. It will soon open its membership for institutions and individuals. It also imparts training for leaders, teachers, students and parents. As you know that we have already successfully conducted 115th session. During those sessions, we have received 12,172 registrations from different educators, 71 questions on national education policy. We have seen participation from 5 countries, India, USA, Qatar, Saudi Arabia, and Nepal. From India, we have seen participation from 21 states and 86 cities. We aim to organize 200 sessions. With this, we would be reaching out to 100,000 educators, 20,000 institutions, and 1,000 plus eminent speakers, like today's speakers, would join us to share their perspective on national education policy. With this, I would request you all, please join me in welcoming our key speakers for this very special session. Our first key speaker, very senior education leader, Puneet Kaur ma'am. Puneet ji is principal with Army Public School, Jammu and Kashmir. She has done master's in geology and BAC. She started her career as a PGT biology from Air Force School, Jammu in 2002. She worked there for 13 years. Apart from teaching, she worked as various positions like coordinator, academic in charge, vice principal, officiating principal. She has received Best Teacher Award twice. In 2015, she joined JK Public School as vice principal. After 3 years, in 2018, she started working in DBM group of schools as principal. And in 2019, she joined Army Public School, Jammu Kent as principal. We welcome you, Puneet ma'am. Thank you for joining. It's an honor to have you. Our next key speaker, another very senior education leader, Dr. Kavita Roy ji. Kavita ma'am is principal with Oxford World School. She's a doctor of philosophy, geology. She did it in 2012. She's also done master of science in geology. She's a dedicated, driven principal with practical experiences in teaching, leading, organizing, and managing educational programs and activities, which involved working with students, educators, parents, volunteers, and business partners to increase student achievement. She has worked with many prestigious institutions like JAMS Westminster School, Sharjah, DY Patel International School, Pune. She has also worked as a senior research fellow at Indian Institute of Natural Design in Germany. She has been a recipient of many prestigious awards like late Srimati Hirabai V. Salgaonkar Award that was given by All Goa Association of Geologists. She has received other awards like Acharya Deva Bhava Award, IIHM Teachers Day Award, GTF Award, Acharya Vinoba Bhave Shiksha Samman, among many others. We welcome you, Kavita ma'am. Thank you for joining. It's an honor to have you.
Thank you. There is a small correction which I request you to do it. It is Oxford World School, Bareilly, UP, but it is located in Pune, Maharashtra.
Oh, I'm really sorry for that. So I'll just repeat that part again. Our next key speaker, very senior education leader, Dr. Kavita Roy, she is principal with Oxford World School. That's in Pune, Maharashtra.
Thank you.
We welcome you, Kavita ma'am. Thank you for joining. Our next key speaker, Suryadev Singh ji. Suryadev ji is head of administration, HR, CSR, and brand promotion with the Radharaman Group of Institutions, Bhopal, Madhya Pradesh. He's ex-CEO with Cinco Renesa India Private Limited, which is a US-based EOU. He's also the ex-head placements with the NC and SD Group of Institutions, Panipat, and head training placement Accurate Group of Institutes, Noida, and Radharaman Group of Institutes, Bhopal. We welcome you, Surya sir. Thank you for joining. It's an honor to have you.
Thank you so much for inviting me. It's been an honor to be with you people and with principals like Dr. Kavita ma'am and others education partners. So
welcome,
thank you,
sir, and we are honored with your presence. Thank you for joining. I'll come back to you. Our next key speaker, another very senior education professional, Gaurav Palji. Gaurav ji is founder and CEO of IntelliClass. Gaurav Palji is managing director and CEO of IntelliVisto Consulting India Private Limited. He's a finance professional to the core and a man filled with entrepreneurial drive and vision. He completed his MBA from IIT Roorkee. He's also on the panel of CII for Industry, Academy and Skill Gap for last 3 years, and also on a curriculum panel of some universities, including IIT Roorkee. He has trained hundreds of people in India and abroad on emerging concepts in financial markets domain, and has been associated with the NCDEX to train brokerage companies in India on their behalf. IntelliClass aims to provide complete e-learning solution and online exam preparations blended with classroom experience. We welcome you, Gaurav sir. Thank you for joining. It's an honor to have you. Our next key speaker, Dr. R.P. Pandey. Dr. Pandey is assistant professor with SRM University, Haryana. He was a FAPESP postdoctoral fellow, which is a very prestigious fellowship of Latin America. He was a research associate at the Translational Health Sciences and Technology Institute. He did his doctorate degree in 2014 from University of Delhi and Tuberculosis Aerosol Challenge Facility. He is an editorial board member with more than 10 journals and editor-in-chief of Indian Journal of Hospital Infection. He has been awarded the Department of Science and Technology, Government of India Young Scientist Award, a senior research fellowship from Indian Council of Medical Research, Indian Immunology Society. He has also received Young Scientist Award from European Federation of Immunological Societies Travel Award, British Society of Immunology Travel Award. We welcome you, Dr. Pandey. Thank you for joining.
Thank you very much for nice introduction. Thank you very much.
I believe so far we have three senior education educators from the biology field. So I'm sure we are going to find the solution how we are going to eliminate corona today only. Thank you for joining, Dr. Pandey.
Thank you.
I'll come back to you. And our last key speaker for this very special session, Ms. Soumya Srivastava. Soumya is manager with Fatado School of Music. Fatado School of Music is India's largest music educator. It is a brand which is synonym to music in our country. It has a 150-year-old rich legacy. It has been working with 200-plus leading schools of India. Fatados has trained over 1 lakh students so far. It owns many renowned titles like Bandit, which is India's largest school-level music competition to promote music talents across all schools. Other titles are like Piano Concert, Cadence Workshop, High Jump Training, FSM Exams, In-Center Recital, FSM Recital. It enjoys partnerships with renowned institutions like Berklee College of Music and NMIMS School of Performing Arts. We welcome you, Soumya. Thank you for joining. It's an honor to have you.
Thank you so much. Thanks a lot for having me here.
Welcome. Now, with this, we'll begin this. We come to the next part of the session, which is the opening remark. I'll request all our key speakers if we can have your quick 1 minute opening remark. Then I'll come back to you for your main talk. So I'll begin with Puneet Kaur ma'am. Puneet ma'am, if we can have your quick 1 minute opening remark.
Good afternoon, everyone. Am I audible to everyone here?
Yes, ma'am.
Good evening, namaskar to all of one. And we are here to discuss an EP. And I came to know so many eminent educationists and experienced than me are here. And we will be able to find something out of it because it is a big ocean from which we can only just pull out one bucket only today. And hopefully, I think we all will have our views on it and we will be able to discuss something fruitful, right? Because I find that many of the webinars in this regard are going on at every platform, but hardly I join any because I find nothing fruitful coming out of those discussions, out of those webinars, because we are just beating the bushes and not actually being the principal of the school. Actually, what we have at ground level, because this is just they have given us just data that this is what is going to happen in your school in coming years. And here I hope that we all will discuss about what will be our contribution at the ground level, starting from the basics. Because talking about we will do this, that, but what actually we have started with this framework and what we have planned for coming session with NEP, that will be, I think, enlightening for all of us and all the viewers, so that practically things can be discussed and implemented in the schools. Thank you.
Thank you, we are very honored that so many webinars are going on. This is the only webinar you joined. So we are very honored, and it's a big validation. And I'm sure you said like we are going to pull out just a bucket out of that ocean, and I'm sure that bucket will have the crux of the entire ocean. So I'm sure we are going to find a lot of practical ways, you know, how we can utilize, how we should perceive this national education policy in the most practical way. And I'm going to share, after this opening remark part, I'm going to share what we have learned so far during our last 115 sessions. I'm sure that would be helpful as well. So with this, I would request Dr. Kavita Roy, ma'am, if you can have your quick 1 minute opening remark.
Yeah, so good afternoon to all the educators and the pedagogical leaders and each and every individual who have joined today's session in order to decode NEP. So what I personally feel is like, why so many questions are hovering, why we are feeling that will I be affected or will I be destructed or will I be afflicted or am I going to get augmented with this policy? So it is basically an inevitable part of the government policy. Let's wait for the SOP to come and let's practically with an overwhelming response, we should actually accept it, because we as in human beings, our minds are so very conditioned. So whenever something new is being offered, we always have lots and lots of questions hovering. I do understand that will always be there, because we believe that everything, whatever being is imposed, it has to be effectively implemented. So definitely we are here to look upon certain solutions, for which there is a lot of debate, which is obviously happening, as ma'am has told, in different forums, a lot of webinars, a lot of sessions. So just we should welcome this, because it's happening after 34 years. That's what I believe. So let's give a chance to this. Wait for the SOP and let's give a try. Thank you.
Well, thank you, Kavita ma'am. And today we don't have Mr. Jaswinder Singh. Jaswinder ji is another resident panelist. He is from Gujarat, so he has very closely worked with Modi ji's government previously there. So whenever he listens to these kind of things, let's give it a try, he always comes back with a argument that Modi ji never gives any space for trying. He gives an option with one option only, that we have to do it. Absolutely, absolutely. So thank you, Kavita ma'am. I'll be coming back to you for your main talk. Now I would request Suryadev sir. Suryadev sir, you have worked with corporates. You are in education for last so many years. I'm sure you have a different perspective on national education policy. Your opening remarks, sir.
Thank you so much, Rajul, for my remarks, for inviting me for my remarks. I am very, very positive about new education policy. And this could have been the best policy, because as Kavita Roy madam told, it's been so many years that we have redesigned or restructured our education policy. But I would say that whatever try had been made, it was just a minor one. So I could see this education policy, what we have been following, it has never not given us any world-class institution for last 70, 80 years. That was before 1947, like Nalanda Vishwavidyalaya, then we had Vikramshila Vishwavidyalaya, then we had Takshila. So it was very, very necessary. And this is the significance of new education policy. And the policy what are let down, what I feel is near to be the ideal one, right? We are mechanical engineers, so we design machines and we study science, but we keep something as an ideal, but practically those are not reachable. Those are not practical. So coming back to education policy, these policy are very, very, as per the demand of the are very near to the ideal policy. So this is my opening remarks. I will elaborate, because I have worked with so many scientists closer. I have worked in corporates. I have worked in schools also. I go to different schools and universities to deliver lectures. So I will elaborate later on. But since you've asked me for one minute remarks,
right?
So sir. I would take a liberty. You know, we have Dr. Ajay Singh sir with us. He is heading our mechanical engineering department. So I would like you to introduce him also, because you know I wanted him because he is heading incubation center, a research center of our group. I invited him, so he is there. So Dr.
I'll invite Dr. Ajay ji later. Yeah. During the session. Welcome, Ajay sir, thank you for joining, and I'll come back to you. And you know, I have a remark. I'm fully agree with Suradev sir that you know, but this is very ironical that the world class institutions we have today, like IIMs or IITs, you know, they were established before the arrival of the first national education policy. And after the arrival of first education policy that came in 1968, we haven't, hardly any, established any of that kind of institution. So now let's have an opening remark from Gaurav Pal sir. Gaurav sir, can we have your opening remark? Welcome and please.
Right. Thank you, Rajiv. First of all, I would like to convey my best regards to all the educators over here. I have got an opportunity to work with some schools in last 8-9 months. And I would like to say by heart, you guys are the real corona warriors, you know. What kind of stress school is going through in last almost a year now, and what kind of efforts you teachers are putting into, that is really commendable. That was not seen before at any point of time. So the kind of work you guys are doing, working almost 12 hours a day, making sure education is being delivered on a continuous basis, and session is going on. So my hats off to all of you. In terms of the national education policy, I would like to add one thing over here, that nothing that could be compared better than education, because education is something which gives hope. And this is what we need at this point of time, what we have seen during this lockdown of last 1 year. So education policy or education should be designed in a way where it should spread hope and happiness, and should develop people into a better human being. So I think there's a lot of scope for implementation of these basic goals. Whenever there is a confusion, the best thing is to go back to basics. So I think this education policy will give us an opportunity to reboot ourselves and to start thinking fresh from the basics, the real purpose of education, I would say. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. We also hope that we find a way to achieve that. Thank you. Now I would request Dr. Pandey, sir, if you can have your opening remark.
Yeah, so thank you very much. And I would like to give my special thanks to School Lalaji to organizing such type of event. And successful, congratulations, that is I think that is 115 or 116 today. So that is really 116, that is really great thing. And you have invited all the time good speaker, and you have compiled all the documents. So hats off to you, that the work that you have done, because any policy that come, that is a topic of debate. It had both the parts. It had good and it had some negative part. But here we are here to discuss about how we are going to improve it. But country like India, we need to change the education policy that is going to happen after 34 years. And there are some points here. I am hopeful that this policy will change our country, will bring the new skilled country. So I will come to my final talk. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Pandey. We'll come back to you. Now I would request Ms. Soumya Srivastava. Soumya, can we have your opening remark?
First of all, thank you so much for having me here. I'm really looking forward to hearing everyone. And it's a huge honor for me to be a part of such an esteemed panel. So thanks a lot for that. Coming to my introduction, at Furtado School of Music, we are thrilled to see the inclusion of vocational studies in the NEP 2020. We feel it's a giant step towards the holistic development of a child. And inclusion of vocational courses, such as music, for example, into the mainstream education system will not only encourage children to think creatively, but also gain new experiences, which in the future, will play an important role in a child's development. So that's what I'm going to talk about. Thank you.
Thank you, Soumya. And with this, we come to the next part of the session, which is the main talk. I'll be coming back to all these speakers, for your detailed interpretation on national education policy. But before I invite our first speaker, and before I go to Dr. Ajay Singh ji here, who has joined us, I'll also take his observation on national education policy. But I would like to share the learnings which we have had during our last 115 sessions. Almost every participant during these sessions shared that this is a wonderful document. This document of national education policy, if executed well, has a potential to place India at that coveted position of Vishwa Gyan Guru. But at the same time, almost same number of participants share that execution is going to be very, very challenging. Almost everyone share that we have a general mindset to resist change. The parents, teachers, educators, and most of us generally resist change. A lot of people share that, good schools in urban areas already implementing these ideas, many of these ideas. But the challenge would be for rural schools, budget schools, or, government schools. Many educators who participated share that finance is going to be a biggest challenge. Government is reducing financial expenditure on education, so that shows somewhere a gap in government's intent as well. Many educators assess that. Many educators believe that this pandemic has exposed how badly digital infrastructure has been distributed in our country. So just 24% of people have the access to smartphones. So this is again going to be how we distribute the digital infrastructure, because that is going to be a key part of our education strategy in coming years. So I would request all our key speakers that while sharing our interpretation, if you can also share some idea, some suggestion, for the roadmap, which Puneet ma'am said, like we must create a collaborative, document at the end of this session so that, we can find those practical ways to implement that. So I would request all our speakers, if you can share those ideas. After this main talk session, we have already received many questions. I would be presenting those questions to you all. But before I invite our first key speaker, I'll request Dr. Ajay, if we have your presence. So if we can have your quick observation on national education policy. Dr. Ajay, do we have your presence? Okay. So, we come to this part, and in this part, all these speakers will get 8 to 10 minutes, for their interpretation. And I would request all our speakers, if we can, keep the time limit in mind so that we can have sufficient time in the end for the questions. So with this, I would request Puneet ma'am, if we can have your ideas, your interpretation, Puneet ma'am.
Yeah. See. My interpretation for everybody has their own interpretation. We all are listening to, and we are all going through documents from last year about NEP. But I will discuss about what I feel, what I have to do. And basically, we need to work on, initially, we have to work on our junior classes, that is pre-primary and primary classes, because we have to take step, and then we have to move ahead. National education policy says experiential learning, but we cannot impose education learning at the random to the senior classes. So we have to start experiential learning in junior classes, pre-primary, as mentioned in education policy, that we must focus on experiential learning. But when to start, how to start, where to start? Are we planning for experiential learning? Because all the principals, all the educators must be working on their next year, next session. are we planning for that? Experiential learning, we have to take a stepping stone. How we are planning our lesson plans? We have attended so many webinars of CBSC on these national education policy and all other matters related to it. So I believe that I shall be starting initially with my junior classes, with education, in with the experiential learning, with their concept clearance. That is my priority, that experiential learning is not what child is doing in the class. Experiential learning, how my child is behaving outside the class. Whether my primary child knows how to fill the bottle, how to tie the laces of the shoes, that is experiential learning. Whether my child knows how to put notebooks and books inside my bag, that is experiential learning for me in junior classes. So what I'm teaching, if it is a pen, what my child has concept for this pen, why my child is not calling this as a pencil, why my child is calling this as a pen. So that is experiential learning, which I believe I have to give to my child in junior classes. And then finally, slowly, steadily, skill we are talking about. But are we really prepared for the skills, which we, skill education? Do we have that infrastructure? Can we start this skill-based learning in the coming session 21-22? Are we prepared for it? No, we are not. Not all the schools are prepared for it. So, slowly looking into the what skills are required. Because skill education we are talking. What kind of skill is the demand of the market? When my child who is in class 6, when that child will be out of my school in class 12, what kind of skill I have to impart to my child so that when my child enters into the real world, my child is prepared. So we have to work on all these which education policy is saying. Yes, today's world, skills are very, very, very important. There is no value of education until you have that skill. In fact, teaching is a skill. So that you have to impart knowledge. How you are imparting, that is a skill. And that is what education policy is saying, that inculcate each and every skill for which a child is capable. That means we have to first find what my child is capable of. And I have to work on numeracy, literacy. That is very important. I believe if my child of primary class is able to read, write, and calculate simple calculations, my problem of higher classes will be sorted out. Because we find that children are not able to perform in senior classes. Most of the leaders here, they will be facing the same problem. But why we are facing the problem? Because we are not working on their foundation. We are not working on their numeracy. We are not working on literacy, reading skills, writing skills, and calculation skills. They are very, very, very important. If your child is able to read, if your child is able to listen and interpret that properly, I believe that problems of senior classes will be sorted out once for all. Because we are just making that child, no detention policy is there. And because of that, we are just making that child to pass one class and to move ahead to other class until and unless that child reaches to senior classes in class 9. And there then we just say that, oh, what happened? My child is not able to perform well. So I interpret national education policy has given us a chance to introspect our education system, introspect what we are basically doing. Are we focusing on rote memorization? Are we focusing on their concept clearing, their experiential learning? Are our teacher making them to memorize? Is my child able to write the things which are not mentioned by the teacher? If the chapter is there, the questions which are not in the chapter, if I'm giving one question to my child from that chapter based on learning outcome, is my child able to do that? That is what national education policy wants us all leaders to introspect on. Are we working on learning outcomes? That is very important because CBSE has given learning outcomes. Are we working on that? That is what CBSE wants, that give them experiential learning based on learning outcomes. If child one, class one child knows has to know that 1 + 1 is equal to 2. That is learning outcome, that your child should know the addition, single digit addition or double digit addition. Your child is supposed to know addition. Are we giving that addition concept perfectly to my child? So that any question based on addition, my child is able to do that. That can only be possible if we are following what CBSE is guiding us. And yes, I'm not going to start abruptly in the coming session. I'm also waiting because CBSE will be providing for framework. But what I understand that what I need in this level is that I will focus on learning outcome of my children in various classes. I will focus on concept clarity. I will focus on experiential learning in the coming session so that I'm getting my children prepared and creating a base for them in the field of education, because rote memorization is no solution. And if we are still focusing on exam, then I believe that this education policy will vanish in coming time like CCE had vanished. So that is my point. I can just share that.
Thank you, Puneet ma'am. And absolutely, we all agree with you that we must talk about those practical measures. Now, how we can bring that change? We all know what changes we need, but how we can make it reality? You talked about these strong, you shared these strong points. Like, we need to have more focus, at the junior wing, the primary wing. And absolutely, we all agree with you that, if we strengthen that part, other parts will take care of itself. You also talked about the preparedness of schools for skill education is not yet ready. It's not yet absolute. You also talked about, finding children of students' true capabilities is a key challenge. We need to focus upon those areas, how we can find their true interest and passion and those capabilities. You also talked about, and you shared your assessment, that NEP has a potential to take us away from that established rote learning education system. So thank you, Puneet ma'am. I'll be coming back to you with questions. Thank you for your remarks. I'll be coming back to you. Now, with this, I would request Kavita ma'am. Kavita ma'am, if we can have your ideas and your interpretation. Kavita ma'am.
Yes, Mr. Rajul, I would like to share my screen to give my interpretation in a detailed way within the stipulated time frame as you have suggested. That is 8 minutes, if not mistaken.
Right.
Yeah.
So your screen is visible, ma'am.
Yeah, my screen is visible. Just give me 2 minutes. Yeah, I'm just opening my PPT. I know it is, yeah. Is it visible to everyone?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. So what I understood with the NEP, which I thoroughly read it, because this is the National Education Policy issued, which is a 64 page document, which is being shared by the MHRD, which is now considered as Ministry of Education, right? So that is there. So if we consider the salient features of NEP, because I am a person who believes in visual reinforcement. So that's the reason I always go ahead with the PPT, which makes everything very clear to everyone, right? So the salient features, if we consider of NEP, it is basically the school bifurcated under three major reforms, that is under school education, under examination policy, and higher education. So yes, this is something which has happened, which is going to happen if we are going to implement the same. But then, as you said, we have to do it. There is no try which is there. So the first one is basically reformed curriculum and the pedagogy. It has to be holistic. Yes, there has to be a perfect amalgam of scholastic and the co-scholastic areas. It has to be integrated. Yes, as ma'am said, there are a lot of manuals which are being shared by CBSE, art integration, which is actually being advised till the foundation stage. The sessions has to be enjoyable. It has to be engaging. Yes, it has to be experiential. We have to give our learners a lot of hands-on experience. So we all are aware that the revised curricula or the pedagogical structure will be 5+3+3+4. So 3 years of Anganwadi that is being suggested and 12 years of normal school. And then the terminologies are also slowly going to be changed. That is foundation, preparatory, middle, and secondary one. If we move ahead, yes, the NEP is focusing more on early childhood care and education and focusing a lot on foundation literacy and numeracy. This will be the prerequisite to learning. It is already there in place. We are doing a lot of activities in relation to enhancing the literacy and numeracy. But then this has to be the main area or the foundation for, this has to be the main area which has to be enhanced within the foundation stage. That's what the NEP suggests. Now, this, what I personally believe to be a point of debate wherein promoting the multilingualism and power of language in teaching and learning as it is being suggested. Now in India, there are altogether 22 plus languages which are being spoken. So how are we going to give justice to this particular point of NEP, which is a point of debate according to me, which I personally feel we shouldn't encourage this, because then just imagine if we are going to an ATM machine and then looking for 22 languages to choose up and end up with one of our choice and then going ahead with the procedure. So it will be very difficult for us. Yes, the NEP has given us a lot of flexibility. So each learner's ability will be actually enhanced. It will be groomed as per their talents and interest. That is going to happen. It has given a lot of emphasis on conceptual understanding, creativity, and critical thinking. Yes, it's going to encourage the logical and decision-making skills. There are a lot of life skill sessions which NEP is promoting, and I don't think so NEP is promoting right now. That's the reason we are doing. It's already there in our most of the session. We are enhancing communication, cooperation, teamwork, and resilience. So these are already in place. We are conducting a lot of sessions for the children. It is happening. We are actually encouraging the ethics and human and constitutional values. So these are also there. It actually starts from their own house, their own home. And then extensive use of technology. Yes, this is something which is really a best part of NEP for the Divyang students. So that will be a good one. Students will also be encouraged to develop vocation of their choices, and there will be 10 bagless days as a part of Lok Vidya initiative. A national committee for integration of vocational education will be constituted under this MOE. There will be a lot of focus on formative assessment rather than summative one to end. That will be there. There will be a comprehensive reporting which is going to happen to enhance the skills and capabilities and not just the academic record. This is something which is there, that no hard separations are going to happen between arts stream and science, between the curricular, extracurricular activities, between vocational and academic stream. So these things will be ruled out. There will be multidisciplinary and holistic education is something which we are focusing on. So the second part is basically transforming the culture of assessment. Yes, this will be adding a lot of values in the current education system going ahead, going beyond this formative and summative. So we will be actually encouraging high order thinking skills, critical thinking, and conceptual clarity will be there. Parakh performance assessment, review, and analysis of knowledge for holistic development will be established. So that's what they are stating. The students will also be offered high quality aptitude test twice a year by National Testing Agency. So this will be implemented. So this is a good part. That's what the induction or the implementation of AI based software will be there. But how, that's what ma'am is saying. So that's the roadmap has to be discussed. So, and then if we come to higher education, yes, there will be something which is called an academic bank of credit will be given to the students who are going ahead with sabbatical. So if it's a degree program and they are exiting after 1 year, definitely they will be getting a certificate of completion of 1 year. After 2 years, yes, diploma, and then completion of the course, the degree will be allocated to that particular candidate. the UGC and AICTE will be merged. MPhil will be discontinued. So these are beyond the school curricula, which is there. We are not missing out our teachers. We are asking them to go ahead with experiential learning. We are asking them, like, these are the skills which has to be enhanced. But we, as in pedagogical leader, we have to empower our teachers first, then expect an outcome from their end. So there's a lot of things which are going to happen for the teachers. The recruitment, the continuous professional development should be there, though it is there, but now it is well groomed and will be provided in a very better manner. National professional standards for teachers has to be set by 2022. This is really going to add a lot of values for the teachers. It will not be merely holding a BA degree and coming to the school and start teaching. No, I have a good crowd of teachers who are not even holding that particular degree, but they are so very passionate for this profession. And that is what we are looking for. And we are grooming them. We have continuous teacher professional development program. So that's what we are looking for. We are looking for passionate teachers who should be devoted. There will be a lot of online education and digital education, which is already in place. And thanks to this pandemic, which has given us this platform too early, which we wouldn't have accepted. That's what I believe, because if there wouldn't be a pandemic, we would have been a little hesitant in accepting that. That's what I believe. And that could be a point of debate, which might have happened. But thanks to pandemic, that there's a lot of virtual session, which is already in place. So what I personally feel is, like, we and human beings shouldn't keep our mind conditioned. It has to be open. We should accept everything, whatever is coming, and look for solutions. So this is my interpretation, which I have shared. Regarding experiential learning in OWS, in my school, it is already in place. There's a lot of hands-on experiences which are being given to the children. There's a lot of concepts which are being related to the real life scenario, which is already there. I do understand it becomes a little difficult, but then, yes, we should give it up. Thank you.
Thank you, Kavita ma'am, for sharing these wonderful thoughts and your interpretation on national education policy. You know, you talked about, the division of NEP in different parts. You also talked about the focus on NEP, be it in flexibility, choosing subjects, or the key skills, which we call 21st age century's key skills, like creativity, conceptual clarity, critical thinking. You also talked about ethics and human and constitutional ways. You shared your assessment that we already have, we are implementing these values. We are trying to inculcate these values among our learners. But this NEP has formally recognized the importance and the importance of inculcating these values among our learners. You also talked about that NEP offers a lot of initiatives to empower teachers, you know, starting from their recruitment, then training, and then, you know, that continuous training process, be it 50 hours of CPD or other ways. Then, you shared your thought and you called upon all the leaders that, you know, we must find, and we always look for solutions. You know, there are challenges everywhere, but, you know, we need to find solutions, how we can implement, how we can do that. You know, in last session, one of the senior educators shared that policies are policies. You know, the logics are logics, but implementation is the only reality. And implementation take place at the ground, and ground has its own challenges. So you said it very right that we need to find solutions, how we can implement this policy, how we can implement different parts of this policy at the ground. And you also talked about the importance of experiential learning, and you shared your best practices in your school. Thank you, Kavita ma'am, for sharing these wonderful remarks. I'll be coming back to you. Thank you. Now, I would request to Suryadev sir, sir, if we can have your remarks. I must thank Kavita ma'am and Puneet ma'am for keeping their thoughts within the time limit. And you have set the tone for the session, Kavita ma'am, and set the standard for other participants.
Thank you. Thank you.
Right. So, Suryadev sir, ishara aapki taraf tha.
Thank you so much, Rajul. Main samajh gaya tha, because, you know, we are professors. So, we are trained to explain in a way that even a person with low level IQ understands that. So that has become our, you know, kind of habit.
Hamara, so, like, but challenge, sir, but challenge we have seen that, you know, the first speaker or second speaker, unko dhyan rehta hai. The third or fourth jab speaker ka number aata hai, to unke apne bhi thoughts hote hain. Aur kuch thoughts unhone import kar liye hote hain first or second speaker se. To wo mila ke double ho jata time.
Right. Don't worry. मैं अपने आप को 5 मिनट के अंदर कहता हूँ. You know, I will sum up whatever the points I have.
Over to you.
Right. So I have listened the views of Kavita ma'am and then Kaur ma'am. You see, what has already been told, I will not repeat that. But you see, everything has got two aspects, positive and negatives, right? We have to choose in life things or, you know, which have more positives and less negatives. Now, people are talking about how the implementation will go, right? So let me first come to that point, and then whatever the plus point I have seen, I would add on later on. Many of the participants, or Mr. Rizal, you also told that, you know, there is a reality, there is a challenge when it comes to, you know, implementation. Yeah, I agree with this. You see, there was time when a human flying was out of the box. There was a time when communicating without wire was, even communicating with a person who is geographically not outside is out of the box. So it has always been a challenge. We being a mechanical engineer, we being a person from engineering background, we understand that challenges will always be there. But if a philosophy, if a policy, if a, you know, your agenda is not 100% perfect at on paper level, on black and white level, it's not going to be implemented on the ground. So we should be happy about that. The policy which has been let down is good. Now the second stage comes to how to implement that. Challenge will always be there. 10 years from now, 10 years back from now, we would not even thought about, you know, touch phones. But we are now using touch phones. There was a term called in the biography of Steve Jobs, reality distortion zone. So I would add this fact over here that let's not worry about the implementation, the challenges, what will be there on the ground. See, I go to different university colleges in UP, Bihar, Jharkhand, even in government colleges, even in, you know, there are a hell lot of challenges. We'll meet those challenges. But we, at this point of time, we should be happy about that. We have got a policy which has come after many years, and it has got a lot of positives that we should be celebrating it. Now, two, three more points. What I find that it's very, very, you know, innovative that education policy has covered. First one is, you see, any individual who is in an age bracket of 9 years to 18 years to 20 years has got, you know, the highest amount of, you know, new ideas coming in their brain. Our last education policy has, you know, they don't have any much exposure of their experiencing the world and doing what they want to do and experiencing what they have actually been taught. I will tell you, when I was in mechanical third year, I was taught this, you know, design of pumps. And it was in fourth year when I was sent for a training, I could see actual pumping set with impeller.